So guys, if anyone wants to work at Autotop, you don't need a driving license, as you can see.
Yeah, we can just floor it, basically. Oh, tunnel. Close them, because it's cold.
What's up everyone? Welcome to this POV review by Autotop NL. My name is Max, and today we've got a double test. We are driving both the Tesla Model S100D and the Model X100D, mainly to experience the difference between the 100D, the P100D, the Model S and the Model X, to see, you know, what is the best drivetrain. Should you pay all that extra money for a P100D just, you know, for the extra performance? Or should you just go for the more sensible choice, the 100D, which also has a 100 kilowatt hour battery and or electric motor, and it has a bigger range than the performance models. So the Model S fucker the Model S has a range, an NEDC range of 632 kilometers, and the Model X has a range of 565 kilometers. And Martijn is,
I wanted to make him wave, but
really annoying. You can click twice and it will go down and up while it's going down and up. Horsepower wise it's a bit difficult as always, because it's electric, because both have dual motors. So basically I'm going to use something I saw on a website, which is around 420 430 horsepower, something like that, and around 650 to 700 newton meters of torque. The Model S, of course, has been, well, it has been here for a while now, and you sort of see it. Of course, this has had a facelift last year, so it has a new nose, new lights. Model X has the same nose as well, but the Model X has a more modern looking rear end. I think the Model S, you really see that it has been here for a while if you look at that rear end. So don't forget to subscribe, guys. We have videos of both of these cars online already, so make sure you subscribe and go check out those videos about the Model S facelift, about the Model X, about the P100D. I will link those videos in the top right corner for you to check out. Alrighty, we're going to start with the Model S. And see what it's like to drive. Of course, we've got the little car, so you can use click once to lock it, click twice to unlock it, click twice on the front to unlock the frunk, click twice on the rear to unlock the trunk. So spec-wise, we've got a red Model S, as you have probably noticed, with black interior and carbon fiber trim. The carbon fiber is something I wouldn't really go for. They have a lovely selection of woods. As you know, I really like wood, so I would definitely go for that one. But overall, I mean, it doesn't feel that old, because not that much has changed over the years. So if you drive a Model X, it's basically the same, which, you know, is both a good thing and a bad thing. We've still got the big screen right here, about two iPads. It works really well. They have improved it. It is so responsive. You have everything you need in the menu. I did notice a couple of times that I wanted to do something quickly and you have to go into the menu. So it does have its drawbacks, but overall I think that, you know, this works so much better than anything else on the market right now. And it sort of makes you wonder why Tesla can do it and, well, some other manufacturers with big touchscreens or
touchscreens in general can't, or not as well as Tesla. So for the suspension, we've got air suspension, so we can select the ride height. We can do all the lighting stuff in here, the driving modes. We've got chill, acceleration and standard. The steering modes, the regenerative braking, creep mode, everything else. Autopilot, this car has autopilot and it also has summon, so you can do it with your app and you can call your car and it will come running to you. Some more vehicle settings, display settings. So this is night mode, this is day mode. So I think we'll select this one. And well, big map, your radio stuff, and you can get your energy, internet, rear view camera, phone, charging info. So I've got 315 kilometers left, but as you probably know, the range of these Teslas is really dependent on the ambient temperature and, well, mainly that, basically. It's 6 degrees out. Well, it feels a lot colder. It's 6 degrees, so that means that the batteries don't really perform as well as they would on a hot summer's day, which means your range really suffers. I would say that effective range, you know, claimed NEDC is 632. I would say claimed range and real range, they differ quite badly. I would say around 500 kilometers on average should be doable. All right, and of course, the big trick of the P100D with ludicrous mode is the acceleration. And this car does 0 to 100 in 4.3 seconds, which is not bad at all. That's actually pretty quick. So why not put it to the test with our draggy? I've got it set up over there. You can buy the draggy, this one, in our store. Go check it out, link in the top right corner. For 149 euros, including free worldwide shipping. So it connects really quickly if you have Bluetooth engaged. All right, so we'll go to the straight and we'll do a couple of 0 to 100 runs and see what it will do. All right, well, we don't have to do the battery heating and the ludicrous mode and the launch control like in the P100D. We can just floor it, basically. Oh, you still get that electric torque, that instant torque that really catapults you. 0 to 100, 4.27 seconds. Claimed is 4.3, as I said. So that's really good, actually. That's on winter tires, it's 5 degrees, it's a little damp, but it still performs really well. And of course, the cool thing is that it doesn't really matter how fast you go. The moment you hit that throttle, you just shoot forwards. It's really quite enjoyable still. After all this time, it's still fun to do it. Turn around. Oh, that's nice. So, does it feel slow? No, it doesn't, and it isn't. Does it feel as fast as the P100D? No, of course not. But in the Netherlands, this car is about 50,000 euros cheaper than the P100D. So yeah, it's a big difference for just for that sort of one trick thing. We'll do another one to see if it is consistent, like with the Guinness World Records. We always do it twice. There we go. 4.36. So that would be 4.4, but still very close to the claimed number. Driving wise, because you have all that weight, low in the car with the batteries, the handling is actually really good. I'm just going to turn that off. And it's sort of a funny feeling because you do feel that the car is super heavy, but it sort of doesn't hurt it that much, if you get what I mean. It sort of feels like it's so planted because it is so heavy that it sort of helps the car feel really hunkered down, and that's a good feeling. So we also did an Autobahn POV, of course, with both cars. So if you want to check out the Autobahn POV of this one, go check it out after this video. It's on our channel. But they still have the problem with overheating, and heat management is something that will continue to be an issue with these electric cars. Oh man, this actually does it a little bit better than the Model X, but still they overheat as soon as you get near the top speed of 250 kilometers an hour. So we talked to the Tesla guy this morning, and he said that the heat management in the Model 3 was a lot better already. So it seems like they are sort of getting why it's happening and are able to do something about it, which is good. But it does, you know, worry me sort of that it's still going on after all this time. I mean, it has been a few years since the Model S came out, and ever since we've had these overheating problems at high speeds. I know that a lot of people won't do those high speeds, but it has to be able to do it properly. If it can go 250 kilometers an hour, it should be able to do it and more than 10 seconds before overheating. In general, driving a Model S, I mean, I said it looked a bit old from the rear. From the front, I think it's a lot better, but driving wise, it doesn't feel old. It feels really good. You actually have a lot of steering feel. It's quite direct, but it is quite communicative, and well, it just drives really, really nicely. And of course, the silence of the electric motor is really relaxing, and I think is very cool to experience. All right, there we are. Backing up. There we are again. So, did I forget anything? Should I show you any more? We've got a big panoramic roof. You can operate that on the screen as well. I think I covered it all. So we'll switch to the Model X and we'll see what that is like and how different it is to this car.
See you tomorrow.
Bye.
So guys, if anyone wants to work at Autotop, you don't need a driving license, as you can see.
Idiot.
All right, so let's move on to the Model X. Of course, you guys know that the party piece of this car, the Falcon doors, which still are awesome, if you ask me. I think that, you know, the fact that they look so freaking cool, and combine that with the fact that it is actually very practical, because you can get in from the front, from the back, you have a lot of head space, you have a lot of room to play with. Yeah, I think it is super, super cool. I think it's one of the coolest features on any cars for sale right now. So, while they're open, I'll get in. And close them because it's cold. A lot of noise. Okay, so we have got a very special version today, because we have a six-person setup
As you can see, we've got 222. But we have this big center console. And this actually hasn't been available for that long, and you can't get it anymore. So it has been available for around 9 months. And I don't know, I guess people didn't order it, or people didn't like it, or not enough people at least. But I think it's super cool, because this means that you have at least four people that can sit really comfortably. Because I wouldn't call that comfortably, but for an adult, but it's not bad. But this sort of gives you this more like chauffeur-y feeling. These seats are actually also adjustable, electrically adjustable, and you can sort of tilt them to give the people in the rear more space. We've got white leather with carbon fiber again. But yeah, I think it's a shame that you can't get this anymore, because I really like it. It sort of gives this executive feeling, which is really cool. Okay, open the Falcon door. And I'll show you this one. As I said, we've got the rear seats as well. So you have these buttons right here. You click it and you can put it forward, and you actually have a lot of luggage space if you do that. And there's even more under there. So luggage space is quite generous in this car, because you also have the one in the front, the frunk, which is also not bad. I mean, you could fit, you know, another couple of bags there. So it can seat six, but it can also make sure that all those people can take their stuff. All right, enough talking. Let's drive it. So with the Model X, we've actually got the automatically opening front doors as well. And if you press the brake pedal, it closes. So that's really cool. You walk up to it, the door opens, and you sit down, you press the brake pedal, and the door closes. So it's like one move, which is really cool. And other than that, as I said, it's a lot of the same stuff as in the Model S. I think the doors are a bit different. The dash in general is a bit different, but mainly it's the same stuff. So as I said, with this one, the range is a bit less than the Model S. So I would say 440, 450 kilometers on average should be possible with this car, which is not bad, of course. I mean, it will go from 0 to 80% battery in 40 minutes, I think, at a supercharger. So yeah, I would say that it's not bad. I would say that it could be better. But this car struggled even more with the heat management than the Tesla Model S. So it is an issue for us. I mean, I know that for a lot of people it won't be an issue, but it is an issue for us, because we drive on the Autobahn quite a lot. So if we would actually want to drive this car for our company use, I would say that that is a problem, because we drive a lot in Germany on the Autobahn, and we drive quite quickly. All right, I'll get the draggy set up again. All right. So again, we don't have to do anything. We don't have to preheat the batteries, which is kind of a drag in the P100Ds. All right, we'll stop it here. So this car should do 4.9 seconds. Ready for takeoff. Five seconds, 5.06. So that would be 5.1. Should be 4.9. Let's give it another shot. Come on, Tesla.
5.05. Okay, so that's it. So, what is the difference between a Model S and a Model X, apart from the size and the weight? Well, if you sit in here, it feels a lot more spacious. Oh, tunnel. Woo, yeah. Nice. JK. It feels a lot more spacious in here because this windscreen goes all the way up to here with this cool tinted anti-UV light stuff. And of course we have white, so that helps as well. But the seats are on single mounts, so it has just one leg, sort of. Which also gives it this really spacious feeling, and it feels like you can walk around in here because there's so much glass, there's so much space, room around you, that it feels really nice. Okay, let's do another one. Just for fun. Oh, you do feel that, you know, it's the same powertrain, but you do feel that it sort of struggles to that initial go. That's the biggest difference between the two cars in performance. But still, I mean, it's kind of amazing that this car does 4.9 seconds to 100 and that Model S does 4.3. I mean, both are really quick, but the difference is not even that large. I mean, 100 to 200, we also measured that, of course. This did 13.98 and the Model S did 13.36. So that's also not that big of a difference. And that's also because the Model X is the most aerodynamically efficient SUV by quite a margin. I think the drag coefficient is like 0.25, which is pretty impressive. These cars have so much software, they have so much complicated stuff, and almost everything is controlled by this display and this sort of computer. So if anything goes wrong in here, a lot goes wrong with the car. And of course, software is prone to bugs. We've had a couple already. We've had one that it said on the screen that you couldn't drive because it was the car was not unlocked, but we were driving. Martijn was driving at like 100 kilometers an hour and it said, you can drive. That's kind of weird. The other thing is that before we wanted to do the Autobahn POV, the mirrors didn't tilt back, so they were folded in and they didn't tilt back out. And then one did and one didn't, so that was really weird as well. And yeah, I knew. I mean, you still have these sort of young car company things that are still in Teslas. We also just saw the new Model 3 and this morning, and you know, when I opened the glove compartment, it wouldn't close again. This thing wouldn't go back. I mean, there are sort of these weird things that are still there. But at least the range is better than the Jaguar I-Pace, which apparently is terrible. Oh, we're already overheating at like 200 kilometers an hour. Immediately it started to overheat. You can see that the power is limited. It has that orange dotted line. So coming back to that heat management issue, it sort of makes me worry about that Tesla Roadster. I mean, the numbers are incredible. The top speed is ridiculous. It's like 400 kilometers an hour, I think, if I'm correct. But if this car already struggles so much with that heat management, how are they going to do that with a car that's so much more powerful and that is so much more demanding for its batteries and its motors? That I don't really know how they are going to do that. I hope they will be able to do it, but I'm not that confident, to be honest. So the final question I wanted to answer in this video is, should you go for a P100D and just have that extra fun of that performance ripping your face off on a regular basis, and also the faces of your passengers? I would say, if you have that kind of money to spend, go for it. But it isn't really necessary. I mean, this car, this drivetrain feels powerful enough. If I hit the electric pedal at 160, I mean, it still accelerates pretty nicely. And especially at lower speeds, if you floor it, it is really, really fast. So I would say go for a 100D. You have the extra range compared to the P100E, and you won't really miss that ludicrous stuff. You can't do it all the time anyway, so I would recommend going for the 100D. I think that's enough. I'll let you go. It has been a long video, so if you're still here, props to you. You can check out this POV review, and you can check out this playlist of POV reviews. We've made a lot of them, so go check it out, and you can follow us on social media. Just search for AutoTopNL. Thanks guys, see you at the next one, bye.